Welcome. Let's open the word of the Lord together. Acts chapter 26 is where we will begin our time together. Acts chapter 26. Let's pray together. Father, again, as we open your word, we recognize quickly the infallibility of your text. It is perfect. It is right. And this is because it was breathed out by you, a perfect God. We are immediately grateful that you have given us a flawless text, instruction, history, prophecy, all that we need for life and godliness. You have provided all of this in the rich text of Scripture. All Scripture also coincides with itself. And for this, we see your fingerprints all over the pages of Scripture. How though the people that wrote down the text might not have even known each other, you, Holy Spirit, the author of the text, have knit it all together perfectly. And for this, again, we are grateful. Now, as we venture in to discern rightly this chapter, this section of Scripture that we find in the book of Acts, we ask that you, Holy Spirit, would be our teacher, that you would guide us through the lines of the sacred text, bringing clarity where we need it, helping us to understand the text, helping us understand it enough so that we can even put to practice the principles that we see in this text. As we read again about the Apostle Paul, how he dealt with adversity, how he again explains the transformation that happened in his own life. Father, would we be attentive to listen? And Holy Spirit, would you be active to speak? We prepare our heart, we prepare our mind, we ready ourselves to learn from God Himself. This is the sacred, holy, timeless, perfect Word of God. Help us as we read it. And we ask all of this in Jesus' name, and wherever you are, you can agree by saying amen and amen. Let's begin on Acts 26, beginning on verse 1. So Agrippa said to Paul, "You have permission to speak for yourself." Then Paul stretched out his hand and made his defense. To gain a backstory of where we are, who is Agrippa, what city are we in, why is Paul standing trial, we need to simply back up and catch our bearings. If we go back to Acts chapter 25, verse 13 and 14 say that some days had passed. Agrippa the king and Bernice arrived at Caesarea and greeted Festus. As they stayed there many days, Festus laid Paul's case before the king, saying, "There is a man left prisoner by Felix." This is the backstory of where we are and why Paul is again defending himself. Paul was in Jerusalem. He was arrested while in Jerusalem, and a false accusation was made against him. The people in Jerusalem, part of the Sanhedrin and a group, tried to ambush Paul, and the Roman authority there in Jerusalem knew that there was an ambush being set up against Paul to take him from the Roman garrison there that had hold of Paul awaiting trial. So the Roman guard made the decision to take Paul out of Jerusalem, away from the mob of the Jewish group that had really pressed in to have Paul arrested, and they wanted him tried. Even the Sanhedrin, which is the Jewish leading officials that oversee the workings of the temple and all Judean religious practices, the Sanhedrin is the leading body of religious officials. They had a trial, and they themselves were arguing and debating among themselves about Paul. So the Roman guard removes Paul from Jerusalem and places him in this town, Caesarea. This is a Roman providence. We see that Felix is the first governor. He tries to deal with Paul, and an attorney is sent from the Sanhedrin to make the accusations against Paul, and none of the accusations stand. Felix is actually listening to Paul on a regular basis. He's there for 2 years while he listens to Paul and asks questions about the way, which is those that follow Jesus as their Messiah. When Felix is replaced as governor, he's replaced by a man named Festus. Festus inherits Paul as a prisoner, and now it's his turn to begin to find out what's going on. And so when he went to Jerusalem, the Sanhedrin now says they think that they can get Festus to have another trial against Paul. That also does not bode well for the Sanhedrin, for Paul again defends himself, and Festus finds no guilt in the Apostle Paul. And now we have Agrippa. Agrippa is not a governor. Agrippa is a king. Bernice is his sister. Agrippa is now meeting the new governor of Caesarea, and he has his own region that he oversees, and he is in Caesarea, and Festus, the governor, says to King Agrippa, "You should listen to the case of this man named Paul. It's an interesting case, and Paul has said, because Paul is a Roman citizen, that he wants to go and see Caesar, and that is a law that you can have as a Roman citizen. You can plead your case to the supreme leader, and at that time, this is in Rome. This is what Paul wants to do, and Agrippa wants to listen to, for himself, the defense of the Apostle Paul. We see that in Acts 25 as well, in verse 22 and 23, that says, Agrippa said to Festus, I would like to hear the man myself. Tomorrow, said he, you will hear him. So on the next day, Agrippa and Bernice came with great pomp, and they entered the audience hall with the military tribunes and the prominent men of the city. Then at the command of Festus, Paul was brought in. And this is where we find ourselves at the beginning of chapter 26. Verse 1, Agrippa said to Paul, you have permission to speak for yourself. So there is quite the pomp, there is quite the assembly, and Paul is making again a case for himself. Here's his case. If you go to verse 2 and 3, I consider myself fortunate that it is before you, King Agrippa, I am going to make my defense today against all the accusations of the Jews, especially because you are familiar with all the customs and controversies of the Jews. Therefore, I beg you to listen to me patiently. I will explain it all out. You can hear Paul stating, just listen to the full case. Now, familiar with the customs, this would be true of Agrippa, because Agrippa is Jewish, but Agrippa is also a Herod. And the Herods have an incredible knowledge of what's going on with the people that call themselves following the way. This is the same Agrippa that in Acts chapter 12 says, at that time Herod, this is his relative Herod, The king laid violent hands on some who belonged to the church. He killed James, the brother of John, with a sword, and when he saw that it pleased the Jews, he proceeded to arrest Peter also. So the Herods are wicked people. They have been for many generations. They have been murdering those that were pursuing Jesus as the Messiah for years. And now we have Agrippa, who is also in the line of Herod's. And he now is going to listen to Paul. Now you can see why Paul says, I'm eager for you to listen. One, because you know the customs. If you go forward in Acts 26, all the way up to verse 26, you'll see that Paul says, for the king knows about these things, and said to him, I speak boldly, for I am persuaded that none of these things have escaped his notice, for this has not been done in a corner. King Agrippa, do you believe the prophets? I know that you believe. So Paul knows who Agrippa is. Paul knows that the Herods have been killing Christians. Paul knows the authority that King Agrippa has. And so Paul says, look, I am eager. I count myself fortunate to speak to you. You need to hear what I have to say. Let's make sure we have the right perspective there. It's not that King Agrippa is the one that needs, it's not that Paul needs to defend his case per se. Paul has already been told by God that he will go to Rome. Paul knows he is in chains and might very well stay in chains, imprisoned. It is King Agrippa that needs to hear what Paul has to say more than Paul needs to somehow make his defense. And there you can see how Paul says, it's good that I speak with you. And here's the beginning of Paul's defense. If we go to verse 4, we'll read down to verse 11 so we can get the entire scope of what Paul wants to say at the beginning of his argument. My manner of life from my youth, spent from the beginning among my own nation and in Jerusalem, is known by all the Jews. They have known for a long time, if they are willing to testify, that according to the strictest party of our religion, I have lived as a Pharisee. And now I stand here on trial because of my hope in the promise made by God to our fathers, to which our 12 tribes hope to attain, as they earnestly worship night and day. And for this hope I am accused by Jews, O King. Why is it thought incredible by any of you that God raises the dead? I myself was convinced that I ought to do many things in opposing the name of Jesus of Nazareth. And I did so in Jerusalem. I not only locked up many of the saints in prison after receiving authority from the chief priests, but when they were put to death, I cast my vote against them. And I punished them often in all the synagogues and tried to make them blaspheme. In raging fury against them, I persecuted them even to foreign cities. Paul is laying out to King Agrippa his former way of life before the transformation where he understood that Jesus was the Messiah. And Paul states, my former life was exactly where these people are at. In Galatians chapter 1, verse 13 and 14, Paul wrote, for you have heard of my former life in Judaism, how I persecuted the church of God violently and tried to destroy it. And I was advancing in Judaism beyond many of my own age among my people. So extremely zealous was I for the traditions of my father. This is the Apostle Paul, who states that his former way of life before knowing who God really was in the person of Jesus Christ, says he persecuted the church more violently and more zealously than anyone else. to help the person listening, which in this case is King Agrippa, and the audience that's standing around, I persecuted the church. That was my stance. I believed in the resurrection from the dead because I was a Pharisee. A Pharisee does believe in the resurrection from the dead. And we also can see that Paul was possibly even on the Sanhedrin as a young man, because in verse 10 of Acts 26, it says, I cast my vote against them. This is for the martyr of Stephen and others. And you have to be in the Sanhedrin, the 70 ruling religious figures of Judaism, gathered together with one high priest, and they cast their vote on who would be martyred for blaspheming God. And they believed that those that were following Jesus were doing this. Paul is simply stating that he has confidence in his flesh, in his upbringing, in his nationality, in what tribe he is from, in what he believed at the time. And then we see Paul say, look, I was so confident in what I used to understand, and it's what you all think. It's what the Pharisees to that day are thinking, the very ones coming after him. He says, I used to think like that, but I had a radical transformation that cannot be denied, and now I cannot go back on what I know is true. This is the same thing that happens to any of us when we go from darkness to light. We should not desire to go back. Once we have seen the error of our ways, we should be pursuing holiness. We have received insight. We have understood that there is a God, and that his son came and rescued us and made a way for us to be forgiven for our sins, to have a pardon. Once we know this, we cannot unknow this. And this is where Paul is stating, I have so much confidence in my former self. He actually wrote about that in Philippians chapter 3, where he says, in beginning on verse 4, though I myself have reason for confidence in the flesh also, if anyone else thinks he has reason for confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day, of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, as to the law, a Pharisee, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness under the law, blameless. But whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness on my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection, and may share his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible, I may attain the resurrection from the dead. This is what Paul wrote in his book to the Philippian church. I had confidence in my flesh. I was one that persecuted the church. I had been educated at the feet of Gamaliel, one of the leading officials of the entire Jewish law. He was brilliant, well-educated, well-placed, wealthy, respected. And Paul says, I would never have given all of that up unless there was such a radical transformation that it was undeniable. So you can see how Paul is really painting this picture for King Agrippa. Why would I ever have given up the life that I had before? I wholly believed that what he was doing as a Pharisee was right. Now, once that case has been made, it helps us identify how radical of a transformation it really was that Paul, being such a persecutor of the church, to even have them executed, becomes the one teaching and leading and encouraging the church more than anyone else. That radical transformation, Paul now explains to King Agrippa, beginning on verse 12. This is how Paul explains it. He says, "In this connection, I journeyed to Damascus with the authority and commission of the chief priests." So he had this connection to his former way of life, to finding those that were Christians and having them arrested. He is going to go to Damascus to find Christians and have them arrested and brought back. But notice that he says in verse 12 here, "I journeyed to Damascus with the authority and commission of the chief priests." Now, we have that in Acts chapter 9, verse 1 and 2. It says, Saul, which is Paul's former name, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues at Damascus, so that if he found any belonging to the way, men or women, might bring them bound to Jerusalem. Now, it's important that we recognize what Paul's doing here. Paul's no fool. Paul is speaking to the king, Agrippa, and he says, "I have on record a decree given to me that I was allowed to go to Damascus and arrest people following Jesus." In other words, it's on record. You can go look it up for yourself. I was one of them. I was a persecutor of the church. Something clearly, radically happened for me to shift so drastically. And that's what he explains here in verse 13, Acts 26. "At midday, O king, I saw on the way a light from heaven, brighter than the sun, that shone around me and those who journeyed with me." If we pause there, there's several keys here. One is at midday, so the sun is at its peak, it's at its highest place. Remember, he's on the road from Jerusalem to Damascus. At the height of the day, there was another light that was brighter than the sun, this, in a sense, unapproachable light. If you remember, Paul was blinded by this light. It was so intense. Now, 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 15 and 16, Paul tries to describe how bright this light is. He says, "He who is the blessed and only sovereign, the King of kings and the Lord of lords, who alone has immortality, who dwells in unapproachable light, who no one has ever seen or can see, to him be honor and eternal dominion." He uses the phrase unapproachable light. This is that light, that Shekinah glory-like brilliance that is so bright that it's terrifying. It's bright enough that in the middle of the day, it's brighter than the sun. So Paul is trying to state again to King Agrippa that something so dramatic happened that it was shocking, and there are others there with me. Actually, if you look at verse 14, notice he says, "And we had all fallen to the ground. I heard a voice saying to me," in the Hebrew language. So everybody traveling in the party of the Apostle Paul, everyone traveling on the road to Damascus, they all saw this brilliant light. So now not only do we have on record the fact that there is paperwork commissioning Paul to go to Damascus and arrest Christians, so we have something on record, and now we have witnesses. We had all fallen to the ground. Everyone that was in that party, none of them were Christ followers, by the way, they all saw this brilliant light. So we have witnesses, we have records for the court. You can see how Paul is laying out his case quite beautifully. However, Paul does say, I'm the only one that understood what came out of the bright light, the voice. Here's what it says, verse 14 of Acts 26. Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? It is hard for you to kick against the goads. And I said, who are you, Lord? And the Lord said, I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But rise and stand upon your feet, for I have appeared to you for this purpose, to appoint you as a servant and witness to the things in which you have seen me and to those in which I will appear to you, delivering you from your people and from the Gentiles, to whom I am sending you, to open their eyes, so that they may turn from darkness to light and from the power of Satan to God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and a place among those who are sanctified by faith in me. In the Hebrew language, God himself, Jesus, speaks to Paul. There are witnesses that say this happened. The light, the voice, intense. Now, it is important that we recognize that Jesus was speaking directly to Paul, the instructions. Now, we know that others heard the voice, but they didn't understand it. That's explained to us in Acts 22, verse 9, that says, Now there were those with me that saw the light, but did not understand the voice of the one who was speaking to me. So they could hear the voice, they just couldn't understand it. But notice that the calling was to the Gentiles, from God to Paul, for the Gentiles. Now, Ananias is the one that is given the hard task of going up to Paul and praying for him, because Paul had been blinded by this brilliant light, and a man by the name of Ananias was told to go and pray over him and he would receive his sight. But God tells Ananias who and what the purpose of Paul is all about. In Acts chapter 9, verse 15, it says that the Lord said to him, go, for he is a chosen instrument of mine to carry my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. God chose Paul, the most ridiculous choice to advance the church was to choose the one persecuting the church. But I think it's important that we recognize that the same goes for us today. All these pieces of history that we're reading in the text are lessons for us today. In other words, God does not often call the qualified, but he qualifies those to whom he calls. If you're thinking, I'm not really in a position to be used of God, I don't have any supernatural gifts, I don't seem to have anything that I think would be noteworthy that God could use, well, that's not really your call now, is it? If God has chosen you for a purpose, he will equip you for that purpose. Our job is not to tell God what we can't do. Our job is to be willing to do whatever he asks us to do. Paul was not the choice that any of us would have picked to help advance the church. However, what we do see is that Paul is chosen by God and then equipped by God to do the task of ministry, and he does so extremely well. It's important that we recognize that Paul tells King Agrippa what God told him to do. And this is important that we understand this, because remember, King Agrippa is a Jew. And Paul is saying to him, look, what I was told by God to do, what my commission by this divine light was to go to the people that are the Gentiles, those that are not Jewish. So it was to go to the Jewish people first, which is what Paul did. But he said, when they do not receive it, move on to the next group. And that's exactly what Paul did. He's pointing out, would you want me to be disobedient to the very voice of God? I received instructions and I'm merely being obedient. Another way to look at this is, Paul is simply saying, you, King Agrippa, should take this up with the one to whom called me to this particular purpose. This is a great argument that we can use to this day for ourselves. Whenever we find ourselves reading the Word of God and it might not seem to fit in our current day society because we've adopted things in our society that are not appropriate, and then we look into the pages of Scripture that say we should not be a part of those things, we shouldn't talk like that, we shouldn't participate in these things. When we come against a barricade of people who are upset with our decisions, we have the same kind of clause that Paul had. Take it up with the author. We didn't write the book. So we're going to stay in line. We're going to stay anchored in what God said is true. And as society changes and shifts around us, we will not drift along with society. We remain anchored in what we know is an absolute truth. And this is what Paul does. This is what God said, King. So this is what I did. Let's go on to verse 19 and 20, where he continues to say, therefore, O King Agrippa, I was not disobedient to the heavenly vision, but declared first to those in Damascus, then in Jerusalem, and throughout all the regions of Judea, and also to the Gentiles, that they should repent and turn to God, performing deeds in keeping with their repentance. In other words, repent, turn to Jesus. Repentance comes through this man, Jesus. That was Paul's main message over and over, was that Jesus was the fulfillment of all the prophecies of the coming Messiah in the Old Testament. Paul simply said, this man from Nazareth fulfilled all the prophecies. He truly was God in the flesh. So repent, be covered and consecrated and forgiven and atoned for through that death of this man Jesus. Then this man Jesus completely rose from the dead. There was proof that he did. People saw him, a living king on the earth. Though he had died on Calvary, they saw him walking about the community, talking with people. He was on the earth 40 days after his execution. Paul is simply saying, I'm being obedient to exactly what the heavenly vision told me to do. And the first place I went was Damascus. Remember, Paul is leaving Jerusalem with that decree in his hands that says he's allowed to go to Damascus and arrest Christians. However, on the road to Damascus, he has this transformation. When he gets to Damascus, he's blind. This man, Ananias, prays over him. He receives sight. And the first thing that Paul does is begins to speak to the people in Damascus about the transformation and about Jesus. We see that in Acts chapter 9, verse 19, known as the Damascus Lectures. For some days he was with the disciples at Damascus, and immediately he proclaimed Jesus in the synagogues, saying, he is the Son of God. And all who heard him were amazed and said, is not this the man who made havoc in Jerusalem of those who called upon this name? And has he not come here for this purpose, to bring them bound before the chief priests? But Saul increased, and all the more in strength, and confounded the Jews who lived in Damascus by proving that Jesus was the Christ. So they knew who Paul was, and here Paul is encouraging the following of Jesus. But notice he even says he had proof that Jesus was the Christ. This proof, by the way, that Jesus is the Christ, is not merely the transformation. Paul knew the law, the Old Testament, extremely well, and he was able to take that Old Testament and apply it to the fulfillment that Jesus accomplished in his 33 years. That's part of what it meant, kick against the goads that we read just a moment ago, when it says that Jesus spoke to Paul and said, it's hard for you to kick against the goads. A lot of these goads, what a goad is it's a stick with a sharp point on the end to prod the animal to keep moving. So when the animal stops moving, that's pulling whatever the carriage is or the plow, you use this goad to maneuver the animal forward, to press it forward, and the animal will kick against the goad while it is poking it because it's uncomfortable, but eventually the animal will move. These pricks that Jesus is speaking to Paul and saying, it's hard to kick against this, isn't it? Is the fact that the man, Jesus, who was from the city of Nazareth, actually fulfilled all the Mosaic prophecies, born of a virgin, born in the city of David. Each individual piece that he did, from healings to teachings, walking on water, feeding 5,000 people, miracle after miracle, raising the dead, even when he rode into Jerusalem, on the exact day that Daniel heard hundreds of years earlier that the king would come riding in on a donkey, they knew that this was the answer to the prophecy. And these goads, these principles that Paul knew in Scripture and saw fulfilled in Christ, Jesus said, it's hard to kick against the proof, isn't it? And that's where we find Paul now simply speaking, saying, it's hard to kick against the fact that Jesus is actually the Christ. To this day, the difficulty is not for the Christian, it is for those that are either the atheist or any sort of unbeliever, because you have to kick against the reality that nothing ever creates something, so that something had to create what we now know. This is the proof. Logical people believe in Jesus. Intellectuals believe in the Messiah of Jesus Christ because it's only logical. Yes, we can sense it. Yes, we can feel it. Yes, there is a spiritual aspect, but there's also the practical understanding that Paul puts out over and over again. He says, this is only logical. Notice, though, that Paul says, I didn't just go about telling people about Jesus. I told them they are to repent from their sins and that they need to change their way. One of the things that Paul said in Acts chapter 17, verse 30, is the time of ignorance God overlooked, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent. Paul said it again in Acts chapter 20, verse 21, testifying both to Jews and to Greeks of repentance towards God and of faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. So it wasn't just a message of follow Jesus. He was saying you need to repent, change your life. This is what Paul is stating to King Agrippa, who's listening on with logical explanations of what's been going on in Paul's life for the last several years. Now, if we go to verse 21, it says, for this reason, the Jews seized me in the temple and tried to kill me. To this day, I have had the help that comes from God. And so I stand here testifying both to small and great, saying nothing but what the prophets and Moses said would come to pass, that the Christ must suffer, and that by being the first to rise from the dead, he would proclaim light both to our people and to the Gentiles. This is why I'm standing here, King. I'm standing here because I did exactly what God told me to do. It makes beautiful sense that what we see in the Old Testament was fulfilled in the person of Jesus. Now, no one explained that idea better, that Jesus is the fulfillment of the Old Testament, than Jesus himself. It's called the Emmaus exegesis. It's on the road to Emmaus, after Jesus had been risen from the dead. He meets two people on the road to Emmaus, And he says this to them, "O foolish ones and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken, was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself." Jesus, of course, he knows the Old Testament. He breathed it out. But he says, look at the Old Testament and see how my life has fulfilled those prophecies. And that's what Paul is saying to the king, Agrippa. Notice, king, that we know the Old Testament. We believe the Old Testament. Jesus is the fulfillment of it. That road to Emmaus is found in Luke 24. And Jesus' speaking begins on verse 25, where Jesus says, beginning at the beginning, he speaks of himself throughout the entire Old Testament. Now, at this moment, as Paul is making what seems to be so much sense, King Agrippa is silent. But Festus, who is the governor of this Roman region, bursts out, interrupting Paul, and makes this statement in verse 24. As he was saying these things in his defense, Festus said with a loud voice, "Paul, you are out of your mind. Your great learning is driving you out of your mind." But Paul said, "I am not out of my mind, most excellent Festus, but I am speaking true and rational words. For the king knows about these things, and to him I speak boldly, for I am persuaded that none of these things has escaped his notice, for this has not been done in a corner." Festus is new to the job of being governor, but Herod is not new to being a king. Paul says, look, you might think that this sounds crazy, but the king who I am speaking to, he is well aware of who Jesus was. He is well aware of his heritage, who tried to kill off Jesus and kill off John the Baptist and kill off all those infants when Jesus was born in Bethlehem. Herod knows this history. Herod doesn't burst out and speak that Paul is gone mad. Notice how calm and peaceful Paul is, speaking true and rational words. It's hard to debate with someone or call them mad when they speak true and rational words. Here's the issue. This takes spiritual discernment to really understand what Paul is saying. 1 Corinthians 2:13, Paul wrote about this idea of how people outside of our faith will have a hard time discerning the things that we do speak of. He says it here, 1 Corinthians 2, verse 13, he says, "And we impart this in words not taught by human wisdom, but taught by the Spirit, interpreting spiritual truths to those who are spiritual. The natural person does not accept the things of the Spirit of God, for they are folly to him, and he is not able to understand them because they are spiritually discerned." What's happening and what happened to Paul was a supernatural thing. Now, it does make logical sense, as we have pointed out many times. Paul speaks very sound words. Titus chapter 2, verse 7 and 8. "In your teaching, show integrity, dignity, sound speech that cannot be condemned, so that an opponent may be put to shame, having nothing evil to say about us." That's what Paul has taught. That's what Paul is doing. And as we see Festus jump out of character and yell that he's out of his mind, only shows the immaturity of Festus and the maturity of Paul. Remember, this is why Paul made that statement, "I consider myself fortunate that it is before you, King Agrippa, that I'm going to make my defense." That was at the beginning of this chapter, Acts 26, verse 2. "You're familiar with all the customs and controversies of the Jews." That's what's going on right now. So watch how King Agrippa responds, and watch how Paul now aims right at King Agrippa in verse 27. "King Agrippa, do you believe the prophets?" "I know that you believe." And Agrippa said to Paul, "In a short time, would you persuade me to be a Christian?" And Paul said, "Whether short or long, I would to God that not only you, but also all who hear me this day might become such as I am, except for these chains." Not just you, but everyone listening. And there is a large crowd. Remember, the military is there. The officials are there. Governors are there. The king is there. Everyone's listening to Paul. And now the king has even said, "If I keep listening to you, this seems only logical. Maybe even I would become." This also shows us that it was when Paul was first brought to this particular Roman region, taken out of Jerusalem by custody, brought to this particular region, to the governor at the time was Felix. Even Felix constantly went down and listened to Paul. And it says that Felix went with his wife, and his wife was Jewish, down to speak about faith in Christ Jesus. This is the governor of a Roman district going down and listening to Paul talk about Jesus. Look at what Paul said to Felix. He reasoned about righteousness and self-control and the coming judgment. This is how Paul spoke to Felix. He became Felix's pastor. He spoke about not sinning and about self-control and about making a decision to follow Jesus so that you, when you stand before him at the final judgment, you will spend eternity in paradise and not in torture. This is what Felix listened to. Then Festus is the next governor. Festus is not listening to Paul, but he knows that Paul is innocent. Now we have King Agrippa. He's listening, and he even says, "Would you have me to be a follower of Jesus?" And Paul says, "Not just you, all of us should be following King Jesus." It's an interesting idea when speaking to a king to say that the king should follow the King of Kings. But now the king stands. When the king stands, the arguments, the debate is over. And that's what happens in verse 30. "Then the king rose, and the governor and Bernice and those who were sitting with them. And when they had withdrawn, they said to one another, 'This man is doing nothing to deserve death or imprisonment.' And Agrippa said to Festus, 'This man could have been set free if he had not appealed to Caesar.'" Now, this idea that set free, Paul could have been set free. Wait a minute. So maybe Paul should not have pleaded his case to go to Caesar in Rome if now, after meeting this King Agrippa, he could have been set free? Did Paul make a mistake? Or do we see here what we would entitle the providence of God? It was only a little while earlier that Paul said, "I plead my case before Caesar," which means he must be shipped off to Rome. What we have to remember is that God has a purpose. He has a purpose for Paul. And God will accomplish his purpose. Isaiah 46 verse 10 says that God can declare the end from the beginning and from ancient times things not yet done, saying, "My counsel shall stand and I will accomplish all of my purpose." Solomon wrote in Proverbs 19:21 that many are the plans in the mind of a man, but it is the purpose of the Lord that will stand. Paul speaks to go to Rome. Soon after, they say, if he had not done that, we could have just set him free. God knows exactly what he's doing, because if you remember, God told Paul that he would go to Rome. First, he spoke in just his spirit. Acts 19:21, Paul resolved in the spirit to pass through Macedonia, through all these other communities, and then it says, I must go also to see Rome. Then Paul had a visitation from God, where God spoke to him in Acts 23:11 and said, take courage, for as you have testified to the facts about me in Jerusalem, so you must testify also in Rome. God knows where he wants Paul to go. Paul is a servant of the Most High God. And the question would be, are you? Are you submitting yourself to the purpose of God in your own life? Does God have a purpose for your personal life? If so, have you had this sense of surrender to whatever God wants to do, and however he wants to do it, this I will follow. This I will submit myself to. I will trust in the Lord. This is what Solomon wrote. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Don't lean on your own understandings. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he'll make your path straight. So we see Paul found, in a sense, completely innocent after his communication and his defense before King Agrippa. But Paul will go to Rome, because that's where God had purposed him to go. Where will God lead you? He will lead you where he has purposed for you to go. We find great peace, not in trying to make sure that we have somehow in our own strength figured everything out, or made all of the plans, or in our own strength we have accomplished. We trust the purpose of God. This does not in any way release you from making plans, or for making preparations, or for getting the right education, or for doing what you know is right in front of you to do. Do the very best you can. However, man makes his plans, and it's God who ordains his steps. So make plans, but when things go seemingly awry, the purpose of God will be accomplished. Paul will go to Rome as a completely innocent man in chains. Paul will go to Rome because it was the purpose of God. Father, we submit to your purpose in our own personal lives. Where you want us to go, we will go. What you want us to do, we will do. We submit to your divine authority. We trust you. We love you. And we thank you for this word. May this marinate in our spirit, that as we read, we would discern this not just in our own intellect, but it would get into our spirit and begin to impress on us supernatural things. Thank you, God, that you are truth and you are spirit in one. Father, now we offer to you a prayer that we hope is pleasing to you, as we all pray together the prayer taught to us by your Son, our Messiah, who taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. thy kingdom come, and thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. God bless you all until we meet again.